فضيلة الشيخ حسن حبحاب، إخوتي يا أخواتي، أيها الحفل الكريم، أسعدتم مساء والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. آيات بينات من الذكر الحكيم هي خير ما نفتتح به هذه المناسبة، مناسبة لتأبين الراحل الحبيب حسين، يتلوها علينا الشيخ حسن حبحاب ويتلوها مجلس حسيني، فليتفضل مشكورا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون ولا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله أصحاب النار وأصحاب الجنة أصحاب الجنة هم الفائزون لا يستوي أصحاب النار وأصحاب الجنة أصحاب الجنة هم الفائزون صدق الله العلي العظيم. الفاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. صلى الله عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله، صلى الله عليك يا سيدي وعلى أهل بيتك المظلومين المضطهدين، صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ومولاي وابن سيدي ومولاي يا أبا عبد الله الحسين يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة، يا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة شهيد مظلوم غريب كربلاء، راحلون راحلون أنت والليالي نزول ومضرا بك البقاء الطويل، لا شجاع يبقى فيعتني قلبي البيض، ولا آمل ولا مأمول، غاية الناس في الزمان فناء، غاية الناس في الزمان فناء، وكذا غاية الغصون الذبول، إنما المرء للمنية مخبوء، وللطعن تستجم الخيول، لا يبالي لا يبالي الحمام وهو الموت، لا يبالي لا يبالي الحمام مهما ترقى بعدما اغتالت ابن فاطم غيلو، أي يوم أي يوم أدمى المدامع فيه، حادث رائع وخطب جليل، يوم عاشوراء الذي لا أعان الصحب فيه ولا أجار القبيل، يا ابن بنت النبي ضيعت العهد رجال والحافظون قليل، ما أطاعوا النبي فيك وقد مالت بأرماحهم عليك الذحول، يا جوادا يا جوادا يا جوادا أدمى الجواد من الطعن وولى ونحره مبلول، أتراني أعير وجهي صونا وعلى وجهه تجول الخيول، أتراني ألذ الماء شربا ولما يروى من مهجة الإمام الغليل، يا غريب يا غريب الديار صبري غريب، وقد قتيل العدا نومي قتيل. أبو عبد الله الحسين سيد الشهداء سلام الله عليه، نقرأ في زيارة وارث أنه وريث الأنبياء جميعا كما ورد عن الإمام الصادق عليه السلام في هذه الزيارة، نقرأ: السلام عليك يا وارث آدم صفوة الله، السلام عليك يا وارث نوح نبي الله، السلام عليك يا وارث إبراهيم خليل الله، السلام عليك يا وارث موسى كليم الله، السلام عليك يا وارث عيسى روح الله، السلام عليك يا وارث محمد حبيب الله. نعم، الحسين بن علي عليه السلام ورث الأنبياء كلهم جميعا، ورثهم بمواقفهم، ورثهم بتضحياتهم، ورثهم برسالاتهم، ورثهم بجهادهم وجهودهم، وورثهم أيضا بمصائبهم ونكباتهم وآلامهم والمطبات الكثيرة والآلام المدلهمة التي واجهوها في الحياة، بحيث أن هذه الآلام، الفرق بين الأنبياء ومصائبهم ومصيبة الحسين بن علي، أن هذه الآلام والمصائب توزعت على الأنبياء جميعا في أوقات مختلفة وفي أماكن مختلفة، لكن هذه المصائب والآلام تجمعت على الحسين بن علي عليه السلام في يوم واحد وهو يوم كربلاء. التكليف ارتفع عن إبراهيم الخليل عليه السلام في المرحلة الأخيرة فلم يذبح ابنه إسماعيل، والتكليف ارتفع أيضا عن إسماعيل نفسه عليه السلام إذ لم يصل إلى مرحلة الذبح، وارتفع التكليف عن نبي الله أيوب عادت إليه أمواله وصحته، نعم، في المرحلة الأخيرة، وارتفع التكليف عن كثير من الأنبياء في مراحلهم الأخيرة في حين تطبيقها والالتزام بها والخضوع لها، إلا الحسين بن علي عليه السلام لم يرتفع عنه التكليف حتى ارتفع رأسه على رؤوس الرماح. نعم، لم يرتفع التكليف عن أبي عبد الله الحسين حتى ارتفع رأسه على رؤوس الرماح، لم يرتفع التكليف عن أبي عبد الله الحسين عليه السلام حتى رأى أهل بيته وأصحابه مدرجين أمامه في ساحة كربلاء، لم يرتفع التكليف عن أبي عبد الله الحسين حتى ذبح ولده الرضيع بين يديه، لم يرتفع التكليف عن أبي عبد الله الحسين حتى بقي وحيدا فريدا في ساحة كربلاء وهو ينادي: هل من ناصر ينصرنا؟ هل من معين يعيننا؟ هل من موحد يخاف الله فينا؟ من في الخيام؟ أين هم الأصحاب؟ أين هم المدافعون؟ لم يكن في الخيام إلا زينب. سمعته زينب سلام الله عليها، أخته زينب، قالت له أخي أخي من تنادي من تنادي قرحت فؤادي إن كنت تنادي صحبك فها هم راقدون قد صرعهم ريب المنون يا غريب يا غريب الديار صبري غريب وقتيل العدا نومي قتيل إن لله وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين والحمد والشكر لله رب العالمين. اللهم بلغ ما قرأنا من كتابك المنزل على نبيك المرسل وما تلون من سيرة أوليائك لروح المرحوم الذي اجتمعنا من أجله وبسببه المرحوم حسين بز، وإلى روحه الطاهرة، وإلى أرواح أمواتنا وأمواتكم جميعا. رحم الله من قرأ السورة المباركة الفاتحة.
شكرا للمقرئ المجيد الشيخ حسن حبحاب صاحب السماحة الإمام السيد حسن القزويني، فضيلة الشيخ حسن حبحاب، إخوتي أخواتي، أيها الحفل الكريم، غادرنا ورحل ملوحا بمنديل وداعه أي بسمته المعهودة. أسئلة كثيرة تجول في كيان من عرفه عن كثب، لماذا هذه السرعة يا حسين؟ غبار الطريق يعمينا، وجع كبير يعتصر القلب، وما من مهدئات. حياته لم تتسع لمدى أحلامه، كما أن جسده لم يحتمل قسوتها. هو الموت الثمرة الوحيدة التي تنمو في داخلنا. حسين الودود النقي المهذب المستقيم اللطيف الحي الحنون، وكل الصفات الحميدة تليق به كما يليق به الوجود رغم قسوة المرض وقسوة الحياة. فقط أود الحديث عن بأس حسين وحكمته وتضحياته، لأن شخصيته اللطيفة المحببة لا تنبئ بأنه يمتلك قوة ناعمة بانت جلية في ثلاثة مواقف في حياته. الأول عندما صرف من التعليم عام 73 بقرار تعسفي، والصرف من الوظيفة هو إعدام معنوي ومادي كما يعرف الأستاذ تحسين، وبالنسبة إليه هو بمنتهى الإجحاف كونه لا ينتظم مع سلوكه الوظيفي والاجتماعي أو السياسي. بحكمة اختار الهجرة، وبمعيار ما قبل الحرب هجرته كانت مغامرة. الموقف الثاني هو مرض طفلته البكر المرحومة تشيلسي، بعمر سنتين ونصف أصيبت بمرض عضال، فرهن 20 عاما من حياته من أجل راحتها ليلا نهارا، حتى أن تشيلدرن هاسبيتال أضحى بيته الثاني دون أن يبدي يأسا أو كلل. رحلت تشيلسي في 25 من عمرها منذ 6 أعوام، ورحل بعض من حسين معها ولم ييأس. وأخيرا منذ أقل من شهرين أحيط علما بأنه مصاب بالمرض الخبيث في مراحل متقدمة عصية على الجراحة والأدوية. خبر مجوب نظن أنه يعصف بالطود الراسخ حسين لم يعقد حاجبي الغضب، لم يتساءل لماذا الآن ولماذا أنا، فاستكمل الأيام المعدودة التي عاشها بشجاعة لا توصف، حتى أن المحيطين به استمدوا من قوته قوة. في حضرتك يا حسين حبسنا الدمع، وفي غيابك تنحبس الكلمات. في حضرتك يا حسين تلاشت الأوجاع، وفي غيابك جف الجراح. فالأسى والألم يشل الكلمة والقلم، والدمع يمحي الحبر، ولا صدى لحشرجات الموت على سريرك سوى ارتعاش شغوف قلوب من أحبوك. برحيلك يحفر الحزن على حناجرنا لحن الرثاء الأبدي. فعفوا منك يا صديقي، كما أردت سنحاول أن نتصالح مع موتك وهو تحد، لأننا نريد أن نحيا بشكل يليق بذكراك. أيها الجميل، نم قرير العين، فقلوبنا شواهد لمثواك. نم حيث شئت ولك الحق، ألم يشرح لك صدرك وبالتالي عقلك بقوله تعالى: وما تدري نفس بأي أرض تموت؟ صدق الله العظيم. الفاتحة. ولد المرحوم حسين عام 52 وعين مدرسا 1970. بعد صرفه من الوظيفة واغترابه عن لبنان التحق بجامعة وين ستيت، وحصل على ماجستير في إدارة الأعمال أهلته لأن يعمل في عدة مؤسسات لتسويق المواد الغذائية وإدارة المطاعم. متزوج من نانسي بزي، وعنده كريمتان المرحومة تشيلسي وجنى. رحل حسين بسلام، محاطا بعائلته وبدعاء إخوته وأخواته وأبنائهم، إضافة لأقاربه وأصدقائه. والده الأستاذ المربي المرحوم جميل جابر بزي، وهو المبادر لبناء المدرسة الابتدائية التي تحمل اسمه في أواخر الخمسينات، وتم وهبها لوزارة التربية. كان للمغتربين في ميشيغان وأفريقيا الدور الرئيسي في تمويلها. كل ذلك تم بصمت ودون استغلال لأي وجه من الوجوه. الإشارة لهذا الإنجاز تحفيز لمحاكاته لروح والده ولروح والدته الحاجة سهيلة بزي، ولأرواح أمواتكم نهج السورة المباركة الفاتحة. The last job Hussein held was as a manager at Habib's Cuisine. He enjoyed his work and enjoyed his friendship with Habib and his crew. I thank Habib Bezi and his wife, Nadia, for their unwavering support through this difficult time. لنهدي سورة المباركة الفاتحة لوالد حبيب المرحوم محمد حبيب بزي أبو طلال، ولأرواح أمواتكم جميعا. Habib son Ali would like to speak and pay tribute to Hussein. Would like to speak a few words.
Assalamu alaikum. Al-Fatiha. Thank you to everyone for being here today to pay tribute to Sam Bezi. I know that many of you have traveled from out of town to be here, and that means a lot to Sam's family, my family, and myself. Seeing so many loving friends and family here is a reflection on how Sam lived his life and what type of man he was. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Ali Habib Bazzi, and I am Habib Bazzi's son. Knowing Sam these last 5 years has truly been an honor. He was admired, respected, and valued by everyone around him, and always seemed to be friends with everyone. His loving and outgoing personality was a result in the friendship Sam withheld with all those around him. I've worked with Sam for 5 years now, and I really do wish I could have been longer. Sam treated all his employees with so much love and respect. We would always look forward to seeing Sam at work because we knew when we seen him, he's gonna smile, shake our hand, and give us a warm welcoming in a way only he knew how. And that is only one of the many things that makes Sam so special. The laughs Sam and I shared will also be missed. I would always walk into the restaurant, dressed for work or an event, and the first person I would go to was Sam. As soon as he sees me, he would know I was there because I needed him to fix my tie. As he's doing so, he would look at me and laugh and say, "Will you ever learn how to tie your own tie?" I would look at him and say, "Nah, I'm not going to. Why would I if I have you here to do it for me?" And we would just look at each other and laugh. Sam's love and care and positive attitude will also be missed. I was always happy when Sam would tell me to sit down in his office and share some stories of his past. And I was even happier when he would give me advice about things in my life that he knows I will come across one day. I will miss you, Sam. And it was a privilege that I've gotten to know him for the last 5 years, but that wasn't enough. I just wish it could have been longer, and I really do wish I had a chance to thank him for everything he's done for me and my family. To Sam's family and those who are close to him, my deepest condolences for the loss of such a loving and inspiring man. His memory will live with us forever. We love you, Sam, and you will always be in our hearts. Rest in peace. Allah yarhamak. Al-Fatiha.
I would just like to apologize in advance if I do stutter or something. I'm not really well with public speaking. First of all, I do want to give my sincere condolences to the family. We did lose someone, a great person. A year ago, I lost my grandfather, lung cancer as well. And to be honest, I'm just as hurt by the loss of Sam. Sam was someone who was open-minded. Sam was a person that had great characteristics. No matter what it was, he was always calm, cool, collective. He always knew the solution to every situation that happened, whether it was restaurant, whether it was a personal situation that someone had, we all went to Sam for it. I got to know Sam for 2 good years. When I first started there, I will never forget how I met him. He walks in with his hands folded like this, and he always greeted everyone with a hello. Like a really extended hello. In the 2 years I've got to know Sam, I've got to know his personality. Jenna, he talked to you about you a lot, and Chelsea as well. You two were his pride and joy. Honestly, I don't hear anyone talk about their daughters or their kids as much as they do, as much as he did. Sam was a kind-hearted person, always was the person that everybody went to. He had the most experience. His stories that he'd tell us, his posture, the way he sat, the way he standed, it all was something that no one else usually does. I have a couple stories that I actually wanted to share. Like for example, anytime anybody would ever walk into the bar area, the juicing, we'd always see Sam sitting in that same exact stall all the way at the corner where nobody else usually sits. He'd sit there with his falafel sandwich. He loved his falafel sandwiches. That would be the only thing he'd eat. And he'd never have any drink. And I always asked him, Sam, why don't you drink anything? Would you like me to get you some water or anything? He goes, no, only drink fancy. So that was an inner joke between me and him. And me coming to Habib's Cuisine, not really having any experience as far as customer service goes, Sam did help me with that. He helped me learn the menu. He helped me learn how to talk to customers, just everything overall. him and also Ali Fawaz. And to be honest, I'm very, very, very lucky to get to know him for 2 years. I wish it could have been longer, but at the same time, we all will make our time. Thank you so much, everyone. Fatah, please. Thank you so much for everyone who showed up.
Thank you, guys. Well done. As I stand before you today to commemorate the passing of my dear friend and family member, Hussein Bazzi. Hussein was born in 1952 in Lebanon and graduated to become a teacher. In the mid-70s, he immigrated to Michigan and earned a master's degree in business administration at Wayne State University. After obtaining his degree, he managed and ran a series of businesses in the food industry. He was one of the hardest working men I know. He was devoted husband to Nancy Bazzi and loving father to Jenna and the late Chelsea. His family was his main priority. He encountered many challenges in his life and he faces them with resilience and courage. When his daughter Chelsea was 2.5 years old, she was diagnosed with cancer. He and his wife spent 20 years of their life nursing her health. The hospital became their second house, and despite of these difficulties, we never were deprived of his wonderful smile and company. On behalf of Nancy, Jenna, and his family, here and abroad, and myself, I want to thank everyone for coming to pay tribute to Hussein. I know that many of you traveled from out of town and used this precious time to be with us here today. Seeing so many loving friends and relatives is a reflection of how Hussein lived his life and what impact he had on all of us. So thank you. Nothing is stronger than the relationship between father and his daughter. Hussein was a devoted father to his beloved and beautiful daughter, Jenna, whom of which he was extremely proud of. He also extended his fatherly love to his niece and nephew, Aya and Adam. Aya would like to share her reflection with her dear uncle. Aya.
Assalamu alaikum. Hello. On April 28th, around 4:05 p.m., I lost an uncle. I lost a friend. But most importantly, I lost someone who took the place of a father figure. My Uncle Sam was someone who I looked up to. Like most in this room, he was an inspiration. Through all that he's been through in these past years, he was still capable of smiling through it all. Even at a young age, I'm able to acknowledge the amount of strength it must have took to be as humble as he was. He was brutally honest and wouldn't miss a single opportunity to mock or make fun of the people he loved. But we accepted the harassment because we knew it was out of love. Over these past couple of days, I've learned the best way to grieve over a passing as dramatic as this one is to look back on the times I've spent with him, to appreciate the time I had with him and not what I won't be able to experience with him. I'll always remember how my uncle would treat me as if age had no number. I am not as close with the majority of my family because there is that language barrier, making it hard to bond. He would try to talk to me beyond, how are you, or how's school? It also helped that my Aunt Nancy was as much of an amateur in the Arabic language as I was. He would go out of his way to make me smile, to ensure that I felt included. It would go as far as call a dog ugly repeatedly, saying he hates it, which left me crying because I found it so bizarre that a grown man could act so childish. This made it effortless to bond with him because he made me feel comfortable. My uncle was someone who would go out of his way to make everyone he met feel loved, regardless of the language you spoke or what you believed in. There aren't a lot of people in this world who are as caring as he was or someone as admirable. Through these past few days, I've seen the amount of people he's touched, the amount of hearts that has been filled with love from knowing him, which shows his true character. Showing how sincere he was to the community, disregarding all differences in order to make everyone feel special. My dad had surgery on his back a few years ago and wasn't able to work for a while. My uncle took his place at the restaurant and would drive across the border every morning just for his brother. Even after, he would visit my dad at the hospital and just straight up just make fun of him. He would pick at his constant whining, how my dad would complain that he was in pain when in reality he wasn't. My uncle was apathetic towards anyone, so to compensate for it, he would joke around and substitute whining for laughter. He has an endless amount of love for his family. Even though a majority of his family, like his brothers and sisters, live back in Lebanon, you knew that he would do absolutely anything for them. No matter what, you knew he would be by your side without having to ask. My uncle was a loving man, someone you could look to for help when needed, even if it was inconvenient for him. The day he passed, I left my house knowing of what was to come, feeling hopeless, feeling like I was getting my heart ripped out and shredded into a billion pieces like a puzzle. Being there with him in the room when he passed felt almost like fate. Moments before, we were all laughing together by his bedside, making fun of him and his old shenanigans. Little did we know that amongst all the laughter, he had passed, leaving us speechless, not wanting to believe that he was gone. From that experience, I knew that he will be okay. I felt like he wanted to pass, knowing that we could still laugh and smile without him. But it's because of him that we will continue to smile. Why we will continue to tell his story and embrace all the time we spent with him. My uncle is my rock. He's the reason I can stand up here and smile in front of all of you today. I envy Chelsea, because she has the most amazing neighbor in the world to lay down next to her. Not now, but with patience and strength, we will get through this tough time and fit the pieces back together. Al-Fatiha.
Thank you, Ayah. He's an esteemed scholar full of wisdom who inspires many in our community. Without any further ado, I would like to introduce to you Imam Sayyid Qazwini. Mashkuran wa mashuban bis salat ala Muhammad wa al Muhammad.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين. الأخ سمحت الشيخ حسن حبحاب، أيها الإخوة الكرام، أيتها الأخوات الكريمات، السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. We're gathering here today to remember a beloved brother and a beloved member of our community, al-marhum Ustad Hussein Jamil Jaber Bazzi. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower the soul of our deceased, who became a guest with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 2 days ago, after struggle with the evil disease that took him out of this world, this mundane world, and took him to the hospitality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to embrace this deceased with his rahmah and affection. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to also shower his family with patience and reward And thus, I ask you all to recite Surah Al-Mubarakah Al-Fatiha on his behalf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لا شريك له وبذلك أمرت وأنا أول المسلمين. Sometimes when I listen to certain respected speakers speaking about Islam and explaining Islam to non-Muslims, they say that the word Islam is derived from the word salam, which means peace. That's a mistake. The word Islam is not derived from the word salam. Rather, it is derived from the word Islam, which is submission. And this is exactly what Ibrahim alayhi salam says. وَبِذَلِكَ أُمِرْتُ وَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ I'm the first to submit to God's will. So the reason we are called Muslims is not because it is derived from peace, even though, of course, Islam is associated with peace and it promotes peace. But the word Islam is not derived from peace, from salam, rather from submission. So basically, we are being told that the main characteristics of being Muslim is to submit to God's will. That's how we become Muslim. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, anytime we are inflicted with a tragedy, with a disaster, with a karatha, with a musibah, as Muslims, our first reaction should be to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to accept His ruling. Not to say why. Not to say, why me? Not to question God's wisdom. We usually do not question the expertise of our doctors. If I have a doctor and my doctor prescribes me for certain medicine or operation, I do not question his wisdom. Do we trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that much that we submit to his will without questioning his decisions for us? That's the question. Ibrahim alayhi salam, Prophet Ibrahim, the great Prophet of Allah, he sets the example. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him to sacrifice his own son, he did not ask Allah why. When he was being thrown in the fire, and Ibrahim alayhi salam was being thrown in the fire, and Allah sent Jibreel, Angel Jibreel, to ask him if he needs anything, he says, no, to you I have no need. He says, what about Allah? Will you ask him to save you? And his answer was, عِلْمُهُ بِحَالِ يُغْنِي عَنْ سُؤَالِي Him knowing I'm being thrown into the fire, suffice for me. This is the real submission to God's will. When our Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam was sitting with his friends and he was seen being disturbed, worried, going inside the house and coming to the chamber where he meets his friends and his followers, he did that a few times. After an hour he came and he sat and he never went in and he looked relieved. Some of his friends asked him, what was going on, Ibn Rasulullah? Why you looked so worried an hour ago, but now you look relieved? He says, I had a son who was passing away. And they asked him, so is he okay now? He said, no, he died. He just died. But Ibn Rasulullah, when he was passing away, you looked so troubled. Now that he passed away, you look relieved. How come? He says, because when he was passing away, he was still alive. And it was my responsibility to take care of him. But when he died, that's God's decision. I submit to God's decision. I submit to God. Do we have this kind of trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do we trust Allah as much as we trust our doctors? When we're sick, the first thing we think of is to go to the doctor. Because in our mind, it is he who will offer us our healing. But the Quran says, وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ. When you get sick, the true healer is Allah. When we get into trouble with the law, the first thing we think of is to find a lawyer, to hire a lawyer. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. Those who rely completely on Allah, Allah will suffice for them. He will take care of them. He will be their lawyer. When I'm jobless and looking for a job, and I'm being desperate for someone to employ me, because I want to feed my kid, Allah tells me that, look at me. إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينُ. It is God who sustains you, not your employer. How much we trust Allah? We say we're Muslims, but practically, do we really trust Allah as much as we trust our spouse, our kids, our friends? Do we really know or feel or think or believe that God can benefit me more than anyone else and he can harm me more than anyone else? They say a man, this might not be a true story, but it's a very meaningful story. A man was hiking in the mountains. When he was clinging to his rope while hiking, it got very cold and dark, very dark and cold, and no one there to rescue him. The man was being desperate. He called on people to rescue him. No one can even hear his voice. No police, no rangers, no one at all. So finally, he started calling on God. God, where are you? Why don't you save me? So according to this fictitious story, God appeared to him, or his voice. God told him, okay, here I am. What do you want from me? Even though you have never been my friend, you have never be my friend, but it's okay. I decided to come to rescue you, to help you. What do you need? He says, Lord, what do I need? Help me. Help me get out of here. God tells him, you have a scissor. Yes, I have a scissor in my pocket. God tells him, cut the rope. Cut the rope? Yes, cut the rope. But if I cut the rope, I'm going to fall in the valley and I'm going to die instantly. God tells him, cut the rope. Did not you call on me to help you cut the rope? He would not, and God disappears. He stays there till he dies. Next day in the newspaper, it says that a hiker clinging to his rope dies while on the rope, out of cold, while only 4 feet above the ground. Do we trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And how much we trust Allah? When Allah takes a beloved person, Allah means no harm. Rather, He is testing your patience and testing your iman. And choosing that person for a better place. I said a few days ago that we have a wrong impression about death, that death is a bad thing. Is it really a bad thing? No. Death is not a bad thing, especially for those who have good relationship with Allah. Allah will be the host. Allah tells us in the Quran about those good believers who believed in God, يا أيتها النفس المطمئنة ارجعي إلى ربك راضية مرضية. We'll be happy to meet your Lord. Allah tells us that when we meet our Lord, we'll be happy to meet our Lord. A nomadic person, Arabi, he was dying when he noticed that his relatives are crying, and of course he has limited knowledge, not so educated. He asked his relatives, why are you crying? They said, we are crying because you're dying. He says, okay, so if someone dies, what does he go to? They told him he goes to Allah. He says, if someone goes to Allah, you cry for him? If I'm going to Allah, Allah is the source of rahmah. كتب على نفسه الرحمة. He's the fountain of rahmah, the fountain of affection, the fountain of love. Why I should worry about someone who is going to the source of rahmah? Why? I would be worried about him when he is under my mercy as a human being. But when he leaves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I would not worry for him. Because I know he will be in safer hand than my hand. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam was walking with his friends in the alleys of Medina, he noticed a mother hugging her child, her baby, and kissing him. And that scene drew some attention from the Prophet and his companions. قال ألا تنظرون إلى هذه الأم وحبها لطفلها؟ Aren't you so amazed with this mother and how much she loves her baby? إن الله لا يحب عبده أكثر من هذه الأم لطفلها. Allah loves His people and His servant more than this mother toward her child. المرحوم أحسين, as we heard, he submitted his will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every time I remember we used to go to Habib cuisine, he would receive us with smiling face, with a beautiful attitude. And within a short period of time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took him. Took him because he was a good man. And in our dialect, when someone dies while not too old, some of us naively say, راحت عليه. That's not true. That's not true at all. Indeed, when we are chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who will be the winners? Tell me, of those who choose this life over akhirah, what do they get? What do they really get? Other than stress? We have become the most stressful nation on earth. 20% of Americans have depression. That translates into 60 million people at least in the most powerful and wealthiest nation on earth. تَعَبٌ كُلُّهَا الْحَيَاةِ فَلَا أَعْجَبُ إِلَّا مِنْ رَاغِبٍ فِي ازْدِيَادِ. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يتغمد روح الفقيد الغالي المرحوم حسين بواسع رحمته. I would like to offer my sincerest condolences to his wife, to his daughter, to his niece, to his cousins, to the entire Bezzi family, to his extended family, to all of you, my dear brothers and sisters, on this occasion. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يتغمد روحه الطاهرة بواسع رحمته. وأن يسكنه فسيح جنته مع من كان يتولاه محمد وعلي وفاطمة والحسن والحسين والتسعة المعصومين من ذرية الحسين. وأدعوكم إلى تلاوة الفاتحة عن روحه الطاهرة. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
جزيل الشكر للإمام سيد قزويني. الرجاء أتمنى one favor. كلمة العائلة سيلقيها الدكتور معين جابر. أعطوه المجال تيشكركم لأنه إجا من تكساس ما في يحزن لحاله، إجا من تكساس تيشم ريح بنت جبال ويشوفوا الأهل بنت جبال. معين جابر في كلمة العائلة.
صاحب السماحة
السيد حسن القزويني، فضيلة الشيخ حسن حبحاب، أيها الإخوة والأخوات، في البدء أود أن أشكركم جميعا على حضوركم الكريم ومشاركتنا ألم الرحيل المبكر لفقيدنا الغالي الأستاذ حسين جميل جابر بزي. باكرا رحل عنا حسين، ربما أراد ذلك ليكون بجوار ابنة أحب. قيل أنه كان دائم الابتسام حتى ساعات رحيله الأخيرة. لم يقرأ زواره في وجهه خوفاً، لم يقرأ استسلاماً للموت كذلك، بل رأوا في محياه سلاماً. سلام عليك أيها الموت، ربما قال ذلك بعد الشهادة. رحل حسين عن عائلة، عن زوجة وابنة أحب. رحل عن عائلة في لبنان لم يتسنى لهم وداعة، هم الآن يبكونه بصمت كما شاء. رحل عن أخوات اعتدنا على اللقاء أسبوعيا، أراهن يقبلن صوره ويعاودن قراءة رسائله القديمة في لقائهن المقبل. دموعا كثيرة ستنهمر على وجوه كل من حنان، فاطمة، سامية، مريم ومنى. عميق حزن الأخوة الأستاذ سامي، الأستاذ إبراهيم، الدكتور محمد. قال أحدهم: الموت لا يوجع الموتى، الموت وجع الأحياء. ولم يخفف من أوجاعنا لرحيله سوى حضوركم الكريم، فجزيل الشكر لمن اتصل هاتفيا أو بالبريد الإلكتروني أو الفيسبوك، ولمن شاركنا بمشاعره راجين من المولى ألا تصابوا بمكروه. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Thank you.
Thank you.
I don't know.